All right. So this is a pretty exciting day for us, of course, as a church. I feel like we're getting to the next level as a church. You know, we've started off, things have been kind of crazy in general with the way we're getting off the ground. You know, there hasn't always been a lot of notice, and we kind of started just holding church services wherever we could do it, and we've been going along great. There's been a lot of soul winning that's now been brought together, people who have already been doing different works on their own and you know, kind of attending churches here and there, but now we've kind of brought a lot of people together into one place and started doing the great work that's being done. I mean, praise the Lord, we're almost got 300 people saved as a church collectively for the year. That's great. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. That's a great work. But I think now, I mean, that's just the very beginning. That's a little taste of what our church is going to be capable of doing through the power of God. That we are just getting off the ground. Don't forget that we are just getting off the ground. We're just getting started. And of course, it's very exciting to be now in a more permanent place, a place where we could have a home base, right? A headquarters, a central station to be able to come together regularly. Now, you know, we had a place, but there's always been, oh, well, we can't rent out this time and we have to go to another room or we have to do things different. We don't have any of that anymore. And now when we want to do our preaching classes and we want to do other activities and we want to bring the church together and we want people to grow more together as a church family and do things together, we have the ability to do that without costing an arm and a leg that has to have to rent out every single time a space and schedule the time and stuff. We could do all that here. So I'm excited about this. I know everybody here is excited about this. And especially when we have works like this, you know, we want the building to look nice, of course. We care about the work that we do. We care about serving God. But at the same time, we don't, you know, it's not about the building. Right? We're not here to just make some ornate stained glass windows, just put everything into some physical structure here on earth. We're not trying to rebuild Solomon's temple. That's not what it's all about for us. That we're, you know, we're here to do the work of the Lord. And as I said, we're going to respect God. We're going to take our job seriously. That's why I think it's a good, that's why, you know, I've always dressed nice coming to church. Why? Because I think it's a serious thing. I think, you know, I have respect for God. Do we have a dress code here? No, we don't. But you know, I'm glad, for everyone that comes to church, I'm glad you're here today, right? No matter what you're wearing on the outside. But at the same point, there's a mentality of, hey, I'm going to treat this job seriously. And especially me as a pastor, I'm going to treat this seriously. When I go out soul winning, you know what? I treat it seriously. I'm going to go and try to present myself as best as possible. I'm not going to go just disheveled where people aren't going to take you seriously. Like, you're going up to them and say, you know, hey, do you know for sure how to go to heaven? But you kind of look like a, you know, whatever. Appearances do matter. You know, they're not the most important thing. And the Bible teaches that. It's not, you know, it's your heart that matters most. And that's what we need to focus on first and foremost. But the outside does have meaning too. The Bible says, clean that first, which is inside, that the outside also may be clean. So the goal is to get everything looking good inside and out. And the building, I think it looks great. Is it kind of rough around the edges still? Sure it is. But you know, it's a nice place to meet and to get together. And I'm not going to be ashamed of people walking in here thinking like, well, because here's the thing. You know, if you were to bring people into church, because we're going out, what are we doing? We're going out. We're going soul winning. We're trying to lead people to Christ. But we don't want to just leave it at that. We want to get those people in church. We want to get them baptized. We want to get them discipled. We want them to get plugged in to the church family. Once they're born again, hey, that's your brother, that's your sister in Christ. We want them to come in into this house And we don't want to be embarrassed to bring them into our house, right? That's why we don't want to have just, you know, mold growing on the walls and just junk all over the place and just a real messy house. We want to be able to say, hey, come on in. It's a nice, clean house. And you know where I'm going with that. Anyways, we're just getting started. It's great being in this place. And what I want everyone to be thinking about, and I've preached on this already in the past, I think especially when we first started the church, but it's something that we need to keep in the focus on a regular basis, a few times a year, just keep this in mind, and that's what's your vision for yourself and what's your vision for the church? See, I have a vision for this church, and we've already had people who have come and gone through the church, and I'm not sure all the reasons why for that. You know, there's usually multiple reasons why people drop out of church. I've been going to church for a long time. I've been pastoring for 5 years. I've seen it happen. There's always different reasons. But, if the reason is because they thought, oh, they had different expectations of what the church would be. The church is just getting started, right? So hopefully I didn't burst anyone's bubbles by it not being everything that you wanted it to be, because I've been watching church online for years and years and years, and this doesn't seem like it's... Well, that's part of the problem. You've been watching church online, right? People watch church online, they expect church to be a certain way, and then it doesn't meet all of your expectations. Well, if that lets you drop out, then you don't have the right vision. You don't have the right attitude. You know, and if someone is saying, oh, well, why did it have to be Pastor Berzins that came out here? Couldn't we have had someone else come out to Georgia? Look, if your problem's with me, you could look close enough and find all kinds of reasons why you don't like me. You know, you're going to find faults. You're going to find things that I'm not great at or not perfect at. You know, I might not give everybody all the attention that I should give to people or whatever. You know, there's always going to be something. But if your focus is on, well, pastor's not doing this for me, or the church isn't doing this like I expect them to, that's what's going to get people out of church. But that's still not having the right vision. We have to approach this church with, as it ought to be approached, as a body, as a family. There's many members here. And the right attitude to have is not... what is in it for me when I come to church? The biblical attitude, the Christian attitude, the attitude that Christ had is, what can I do for everyone else? What can I do for the church? Jesus Christ gave his life for the church, as it says in Ephesians chapter 5. He shed his blood for the church. He bought and paid for the church with his own blood. That's what he did for the church. You never find an attitude in Scripture of something being taught saying, well, what can you do for me? What programs do you have for me? Well, you need to have this and you need to have that. You know, you don't find that anywhere. It's always esteeming others better than yourself. Philippians, read Philippians 2 and 3. You find that exact attitude, that mindset where we need to esteem other people better than ourselves. We should come to church. Are there flaws in a church? Yeah, there's flaws in every church. But we shouldn't go to church looking at and putting a microscope on the flaws and say, oh man, there's all this stuff. Why don't you come and try to be a help and you know what? Bring in ways of doing things better. That's fine. Try to be an asset. Try to be a help. Not just try to cause division or split things up. And look, no one here does that. It's just, this is the mindset that we need to have, though. We're coming together as a church, and everyone's got different functions. That's why we started off here reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Because the only way we're going to achieve, you know, I don't know what your vision is for this church, but I've got great vision for this church. And like I said, this is just the very, very, very small, humble beginnings for what I believe is going to be an awesome church. And there is no reason on this earth why we can't become, I mean, a truly amazing, turning the world upside down type of a church. There are so many people in this area that need to be reached. There are so many receptive areas to the gospel. There are plenty of people that given the time of day, that given the right influences, can come and be a part of this church and join together with us and get that much more done for the Lord. We have a great group of people here right now, and I love everybody here, and those that weren't able to make it today. But we can't just stay at this level. We need to continue to reach more and more people. The biblical method is about multiplication. It's about bearing fruit and bearing much fruit, and not just getting people saved, but getting people discipled, gaining other soul winners, getting on fire for serving the Lord, and having other people become zealous as well and zealous for the truth. And, you know, this is a kind of a side topic, but one thing I don't want to see people doing or hearing about is giving disclaimers and kind of walking on eggshells when it comes to the truth, when it comes to just biblical truths and things like that. And you know what? I was guilty of this a long time ago. I understand what it's like because there's such a stark contrast between the world today and what the Bible actually says and teaches. And so many people are ignorant of what the Bible is. It can sound really extreme to the world in some instances, but you know what? We don't have to conform to the world's view of what is extreme and what is not extreme. I treat what the Bible says as normal, and everything else is extreme. What this world does is extreme. So we don't need to give disclaimers if you're going to give someone a DVD, right? Well, I just want to warn you, you know, you give a Marching to Zion or something. Like, some people say this might be anti-Semitic, but it's not. You don't have to give excuses or explanations or anything for the truth. Just say, hey, I think you're going to love this. This is a great documentary. Check this out and be excited about it. And if you're inviting someone to church, you don't have to give them a warning, you know, about, well, you know, it's a great church. You might hear some things that, you know, shock you. Look, you know, I don't think we have to do that. You know, I try to be fair with people, but at the same point, you know, this isn't extreme. And I guess the point is not saying, you know, well, pastor's kind of extreme on certain issues. I don't think I am. Honestly, I don't think I am. I think it's just the Bible is what it is. And the only reason people think it's extreme is because it's the world's extreme. The world's on the extreme end. Scripture's on the right end. And the world just got getting more and more out of control in many areas when it comes to just morality and biblical truth. So in any case, you know, we need to, if we're going to grow, everyone needs to be on board. This is a body. We want to be joined together as a body. We're many members. Everybody's different. Everyone's unique. Everyone's going to bring some different skills to the table, different things that God has blessed you with, different gifts. Some people are really good at maintaining relationships with other people and calling and keeping in contact. Not everybody is good at doing that, but some people are good at doing other technical things or other, you know, there's such a variety of things that need to be done. And even just in a more physical sense, like with this building, to put it in an illustration here, people have different skills just when it comes to doing various work. But we needed everybody to come together, as many of the people that did come together, to get the whole job done. I mean, it really required everybody joining together to do something, to do a bigger work. And spiritually speaking, it's even more important that everybody gets involved and that nobody's condescending on anyone else for their position, for who they are in this church, but that we all join together. Let's read some of 1 Corinthians chapter 12 to better explain what I'm talking about here. Look at verse number 12. The Bible reads, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been made all and have all, been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body, as it hath pleased him. God's the one building the body. And it's using like a physical body as an analogy for a spiritual body. And it's saying, look, you've got a nose, you've got eyes, you've got ears, you've got hands, you've got all these different functions that are being performed in the body. And just because one member says, you know, if the hand says, well, I'm not an eye, as if then, well, I guess I'm just not part of the body then. And it's, you know, the Bible's saying that's ridiculous. The whole, all of the different members make up one body. And what this is saying is that God is setting members in the church as he sees fit. God has a job for everybody in church. Every member, every individual, every family, everybody that's here, you've got a job to do. You have something, a place to fit in that God wants you to fit in. And one other point here, it brings up, you know, Jews and Gentiles. In God's church, in Christ, there is neither Greek nor Jew. There is neither circumcision or uncircumcision. There is neither male nor female. There is neither black or white or yellow or brown or anything like that. In God's church, we're all spiritual children. And this is one family. We're brothers and sisters. And we need to work together as one family. And you know what? Don't allow the any worldly influences to allow you to think that there is some difference and cause any problems between you working together with other members of the body because of something so stupid as the color of somebody's skin, which literally means nothing at all. We need to work together as a spiritual body. Let's jump down to verse number 24 here. But also don't forget, because we're going to see this too, don't forget that you have a function. None of you is unimportant in this body. None of you are. From the smallest child to the oldest adult, whether you've been coming here for 2 weeks or 6 months or however long we've been around as a church, when we're here for years, everybody matters. You all are important. And I'll be honest with you, every single person, the people who aren't here today, we're missing them. The body's not whole. The body's not complete. There is a lacking in the body. That's why we really want to get as many people here, you know, as possible all the time. In order for our body to function well, we need the people here. We need you here. You are missed when you're not here. You know, don't ever get this attitude thinking, well, no one really cares. No one will notice. It's not a big deal when I'm not here. It is a big deal when you're not here. There's a part of our body that's missing. If you wake up tomorrow and you're missing an ear, you wake up tomorrow, you're missing a foot, you know, even just a little finger. The things that you might just take for granted on any given day, when it's missing, you really notice it. I mean, even one tooth in your mouth, you miss one tooth and all of a sudden you're like, wow, I didn't realize how much I used that tooth. You hurt your finger. I didn't realize how much I used that finger. You stub your, you know, you don't realize how much you actually use things sometimes until they're in pain or until they're missing. We're in a spiritual body. Don't forget that. Don't forget that about yourself and don't forget that about other people too. Everybody has a job that they're performing here. I mean, we're already growing. We got the point. We've got people leading different soul winning times. You know, we've got people that doing all kinds of extra work outside of the church and within the church. Everybody's important. And if you're not sure what your role is or function, well, pray to God and start looking in Scripture and saying, well, what else can I do? Start asking yourself that first. And if you want more direction, come to me. I'll help you. If anyone needs work to do, if anyone's not sure and say, well, I don't really know what I can do for the church and I've got this extra time, come talk to me. And I mean that really, like there's work for you to do. There's plenty of things to do. I have a running list in my mind of all the things that I want to do. And there's no way in the world, even being a full-time pastor, I'm ever going to get everything done that I want to get done. So if you've got some extra time, I can help you out and tell you how you can be an asset. And there's lots of things that if you're not good at one thing, maybe you can do another. And if you're having a hard time thinking of things that you can do to promote the kingdom of God and Jesus Christ and people getting saved and just other things that need to be done. Just one real quick example. I've been wanting to do this for years. I just haven't had the time to do it or made the time to do it because there's always a priority list of what needs to be done. I want to have pamphlets of things on things like baptism and just common core fundamentals of our faith that when we have visitors or that you can bring with you at the door, you can leave some resource with somebody that explains, hey, this is really important that you get baptized. And maybe we can help increase some baptism numbers. That's just one little thing. But someone has to take the time to go through, to line it out, to spell it out, to put all the points in one place. And you say, well, I don't know where all the scripture references. I'll give you a preaching. I'll give you like a CD of my preaching or reference to it, and you can go through. I'll print out my sermon notes for you. My sermon notes have all the scripture references on there that you can use in making something like that. There's so many things. This sermon isn't about all the various different things that you can do to help. My point is, if you feel like I don't know what I can be doing as a church member, but I don't feel like I'm really doing anything and I want to do more, talk to me about it. I would be happy to give you some things or guide you in a way where you can be more helpful. And by doing that, it's going to help everybody. Everyone's going to be happy about that. It's going to be a benefit for everyone here. If everyone just relies on one person to do everything, there's not going to be that much being done. That's why our church, we push for everybody to go out soul winning. It's not just the pastor's job. And look, if it was just me going out soul winning, do you know how many salvations we would have? Not very many. Not very many. I go out soul winning basically every week, but I'm not always getting people saved, and I'm not getting the numbers that we're seeing here at all. Just one person, and just any one person. Let's say it was just Brother Evan that was going out soul winning. Just him. And we just relied on his numbers alone. That's his job. That's his spiritual gift, and no one else, we wouldn't be reaching nearly the amount of people that we're reaching. But it's not just a soul winning, it's everything. And again, some people have different skills. Some people are good at some things and better at other things, whatever. And we've got people that have helped a lot with even just the t-shirts and printed materials and designing things like that. I'm not very good at stuff like that, but thank God other people are. Something like that would take me a super long time to get done, but other people can get that done much faster. Everybody's got skills, everybody's got talents. Look at verse number 24 here. The Bible says, for our comely parts have no need. Comely just means like the good looking parts. It says have no need. But God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it, or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. Basically, he's saying, there's some parts of the body that might look or appear more beautiful than others. And because of their beauty, they might get more honor or attention or focus. In your physical body, it's like, oh, your hair, right? Someone's got really beautiful hair and that gets all the attention, as opposed to, say, a molar, right? But the hair is only so, it gets a lot of attention, but it only has so much use. Whereas your molars give you a lot of use. I mean, you're grinding up and helping you eat, and doing a lot of things, but it's not that desirable. I mean, especially my molars, I don't know. Maybe Joel Osteen might, his are more comely than mine because they're all white and shiny and, they sparkle and twinkle in the light. But, or how about feet, right? Feet are really valuable, allowing you to get around. They don't smell very good though. But the Bible says there's more honor in that which lacks, right? So even though feet might be kind of stinky, hey, they're very, very useful. They're good. And when it comes to, and I'm not saying anyone here stinks, so don't take that the wrong way. As far as I know, everyone's got good hygiene here. But the point here is what it says in verse 25 is that there should be no schism in the body. You know, no one should be, a schism is like a break or like a separation, kind of just a break in the body and a disassociation there. Because maybe someone says, oh, I want to be that or have this honor or whatever. We need to just fill into our member the way that God has put us into that role, and that we should have the same care one for another and not giving more focus and attention on the outwardly comely appearance as opposed to some other one that's, you know, people who have different job functions and look down on certain job functions versus others. We need to have the same care one for another and be there to help and support everybody with what they're doing, because every job is important. It's going to allow us to get everything done. One example in the church, as the church began to grow, the early church in the book of Acts, there were a lot of things that needed to be done because the church had gotten real big. And that's when the apostles, when they ordained their deacons in the church. And they ordained people who were already faithful men and faithful people to get other work done. But the church needed to have things done, like the widows needed to be cared for. And there's other services that needed to be performed just within church for the church to function and operate and everyone to be taken care of the way that they ought to be in church. But see, they had to separate because the apostles couldn't do everything. They can't be going soul winning, doing, you know, studying the Word of God, doing all of the things that they were doing already, and do all of the other tasks at the same time. That's why in order for that big body that they had there to function properly, they had to have the different members all taking care of different jobs. But they were all important. I mean, would you say that just because Stephen had to work in the daily ministration with the widows that were being neglected, that his job wasn't that important? No, he was very important. I mean, Stephen was a great man of God. He ended up being martyred, but you see, like the work wouldn't be able to be done without someone like him. And the works that we're going to be doing here is not going to be completely done without you. Every one of you. And we're not going to be able to do as much without you here. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Remember, why not keep a vision for our church? A vision of just doing, getting to the utmost potential that we can. And you know what's great about that is that the potential isn't us. The potential is God and God's strength and God's might and God's power. The potential is limitless, really. We're the ones that hold back God's potential from due to a lack of faith or a lack of being able to be used because we're not possessing our vessels with honor or, you know, any other thing that we might do to hinder God's word. We're a hindrance. We want to make sure we're not a hindrance to God's power. There's a lot of potential. Let's have the vision of becoming a church, a people, a body that has the full power of God upon us, and nothing's going to hold us back, and not ourselves hold us back either. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. We need to be, as a body, in unity. We can't have divisions and strivings, especially when it comes to doctrinal, especially core doctrinal issues. Look at verse number 1 of Ephesians chapter 4. The Bible says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with longsuffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. So he's saying, there's one body. We're in one body here. There's one Spirit. There's one hope. There's one Lord. There's one faith. There's one baptism. Notice all the ones. There's one of this. There's one of this. Because we want to have unity. We don't want to have division over all of these different things. There's one faith. There's not many faiths. There's one Spirit. There's one baptism. And we need to all come together on these one things and these foundational truths. So we're not arguing about baptism. We're not arguing about salvation by faith. We're not arguing about who God is within the church. We're in unity about all of these things. We don't argue about them. If we're not in unity about this stuff, we are not going to be a very effective body at all. Jump down to verse 11. The Bible says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. When we are in our glorified bodies, we will all be in unity. When we don't have our sinful flesh, when we have understanding, when we see Christ as he is, there's going to be no more division. I mean, right now there's going to be division. There's going to be people that, you know, we believe different in certain areas, but the goal is to be unified, and the goal is to get to that perfect man. And that's what we're striving for. And to be effective as a body, though, we need to be in unity, especially, like I said earlier, in the core doctrines, the fundamentals. You want to be off a little bit on some minor issues, that's fine. We can still get work done. We can still do a lot to serve the Lord. But on all the core things here that's mentioning, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, we need to come together on all this. Turn to Judges chapter 20. Last place I'll be turned, Judges chapter 20. Judges chapter 20 is, of course, after chapter 19. Judges chapter 19 is kind of a famous passage that's not a very pleasant passage, but it's similar to Genesis 19. Judges 19 is where, and your turn to Judges 20, Judges 19 is where the man and his concubine stayed in Benjamin for a night, and certain children of the devil, sons of Belial, surrounded the house, and, you know, just like with Lot, they pounded on the door, and they bring that guy out to us. We want to know him. We want to abuse him. And the man that he was staying with, you know, they offered up, just like Lot offered up his daughters. You know, they offered up women to appease these devil, you know, demonic people, these children of the devil, these wicked reprobates, these sodomites that were trying to defile them, and they give them the concubine, and they abuse her all night until she dies, basically. They abuse her so bad all night long that she ends up dying. That's how vile and unmerciful and implacable they are, as Romans 1 describes. You can read the whole list. That's who they are, and that's what they do. And they come out at night like cockroaches, and when the light shines, when the day dawns, they scatter, they scurry away. And that's what happens in that story. And we're not going to go over that story. It's not a very pleasant story, but if you don't know it, you can read it later. But what happens then in Judges chapter 20 is that the children of Israel come together because of this wickedness, and I like what the phrase it uses about three times, I think, in this passage. I've got the verses here. Verse number 1 in Judges 20 says, then all the children of Israel went out, and the congregation was gathered together as one man, from Dan even to Beersheba, with the land of Gilead unto the Lord in Mizpeh. So what they did was they sent out this message to all of Israel after this happened, the guy. And, you know, one of the ways that he sends out the message, he actually cuts up parts of his concubine and sends out a portion out to the different tribes and basically tells them what happened. They say, are we going to allow this? Are you going to allow something like this to happen in Israel? And what they do, they all come together as one man. It says the congregation is joined together as one man. They're unified. There is no division. There is no strife. There's no argument about, well, how wicked is this? Oh, well, what are we going to do? Well, I don't think we should do that. No, they come together as one man and say, we're going to deal with this. And they do. They deal with it head on. Jump down to verse number 8. It says, and all the people arose as one man, saying, we will not any of us go to his tent, neither will we any of us turn into his house. They are dedicated. They are on fire. They are committed. Saying, we are unified. We are joined together in this purpose to eradicate wickedness from Israel. And then in verse number 11, it says, so all the men of Israel were gathered against the city, knit together as one man. We need that level of commitment in this church. We need to be as one man, joined together, willing to go and do the spiritual battle that needs to be done in fighting against this wickedness and the extreme wickedness of this world. Now, as part of this body, I'm kind of a mouthpiece for this body, right? I'm like the mouth. And what's going to end up happening is that, and this is bound to happen. It's just a matter of time where the mouth is going to get all the attention, right? But the body is going to be tried, because then people are going to start going to the rest of the body and trying to split up the body based on what the mouth says. Oh, well, did you know what he said? Did you believe that? And what's going to do damage to the body is when the body starts not being unified together and gets afraid and gets scared and starts, I don't think we should have gone and destroyed those children of the devil and called out their wickedness. I mean, I don't think it's that bad. I mean, it's a sin, but sin is sin. That's going to do damage to the body. That's not, that's going to hurt the cause. That's going to, one, make the body look kind of foolish and lose a good testimony. But if we're all unified and come together as one man and have one direction and say yes, there should be no doubt about something like this. And I hope that no one here has any doubt about how wicked and vile homosexuality, sodomy, all this stuff is, because it is vile. It is wicked, and it should not ever be tolerated. And I don't know if there's words harsh enough to be able to be used describing and talking about what ought to be done with these reprobates and how they ought not to be allowed. But mark my words, because it'll happen. The time's going to come. It's happened already in many of the churches that we know that believe the same way that we do. It happened while I was going to Faith Forward Baptist Church. The news gets on, and then people are saying, oh, don't you go to that church? Oh, I mean, I heard it at work. Hey, I think I saw your pastor on the church on the news the other day. Yep. You sure did. And it's important that you stay unified. You don't back down. I know what happened at Verity with the whole Orlando thing. And you know what? Some people ended up leaving. But all that did was end up strengthening the church in the end anyways. But would to God that people could be strengthened beforehand and not have to even suffer that loss of the body. Now the body became a little bit more lean and trimmed, and some of the fat was purged away. But we want to convert that fat into muscle, right? We'd rather not just have it gone. Let's get that to be used. Let's become unified, and that's the goal. And I know that's their goal too. It's not like they wanted people to leave. I'm just bringing this up as a warning to let you be aware that even though the heat might not be on, the full heat might not be on you, it's going to come your way from one source or another. It's going to happen. It's just a matter of time. I don't know when it's going to happen. As long as we're doing what's right, as long as I'm doing what's wrong, as long as you're doing what's right, it's going to happen. There's no doubt. Bible says, yeah, and all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. All that will live godly. You want to live godly? You want to do what's right? Get ready. The Bible also says in Nehemiah chapter 8, you don't have to turn there, but in Nehemiah 8:1, the Bible says, and all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate. And they spake unto Ezra, the scribe, to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. And I love that attitude too in Nehemiah. They came together as one man and said, feed us the word of God. We're here to learn. Open up the law of the Lord and give it to us. We're all here. We love the law of the Lord. Let's hear it. Preach it. That's what we're here for. You come here Sunday morning, Sunday evening, Wednesday evening, going, open up the law of the Lord. Let's hear it. I want more. That's the spirit of our church. We're engaged in a spiritual battle. We need to come together as one man, one body. Everybody has a role. Everybody's important. If we're going to continue to go to the next level, there's a lot of work that needs to be done. The more people that come to our church, the more there is to do. There's going to be a lot of little things that just need to be maintained in order for us to continue going and not to get distracted with other things. But if everybody chips in, I forgot what Brother Joshua said this morning, but, what was it? Many hands make light work, right? So if one person has to do all kinds of jobs and stuff, that's a lot of work. That's a heavy work for one person to do. It's going to consume all of their time. But if everybody could come together and a whole body can function together, things get done actually really quickly so that it only requires a little bit of time from a lot of people as opposed to a lot of time from one person. And the more people we get involved in helping, and it just became very obvious and apparent when we were kind of preparing for this, because I even underestimated kind of how big the project was here. I've done a lot of work before, and work at my house, painting my house, things like that, but I didn't realize, you know, even just with the square footage, this is bigger than any house I've ever lived in. It doesn't seem that way, it doesn't feel that way, because there's only a few rooms. But it's bigger. There's a lot of surface to cover when you're painting walls. Like, man, a lot of areas to tape. That was one of my jobs. One of the days I was here, it's just like the whole time I was here, I was just taping. Like, that's it. But you know what? Other people were doing other things. Other work was being done in other areas. So in the whole span of things, a lot got done. But imagine just one person doing the work and just, there's some painting, taping done today. Well, tomorrow I'm going to do some more tape. And then the next day I'm going to go and, you know, whatever. It would just take forever. But I mean, thank God for this group. And we need to come together. We need to come together as one man and really start getting involved. And I know it's been difficult not having a solid meeting place and things like that. But now we're getting to that next level. We're going to be even more founded. We've got a much firmer foundation in general. I know, obviously, Christ is our foundation, but just for a meeting place and having that headquarters and being able to operate our business for the Lord, we know we need to be about our Father's business. Well, now we've got a place to come together regularly and be able to continue to do that business. This new building, it's going to help strengthen our stronghold, right? We've got a stronghold. That's our church. We're a Stronghold Baptist Church. Let's make it stronger. Build up the defenses and build up our arsenal. Now we're going to start doing our preaching classes and equipping more people to do more service for the Lord. Equipping preachers to go out and hopefully one day go out and start new churches. I don't know if you noticed when you came in, you probably did. I brought this up before. All the invitations and the CDs that are on that front table. Now, it's not always going to be that way. I actually set everything out there on purpose. I want to remind everybody of the amount of work that we need to do that we're here. Now, we're going to end up making that look a little bit more comely, a little bit more presentable for people coming in. But it's a good reminder. I bought all those invites for the conference because I didn't know how many people are going to be there, how much soul winning is going to be done, how many doors we're going to end up knocking, how many people we're going to run into, and things like that. And it was a great event. But you know what? We got to get through all those. We need to get new ones now that have our new address and things like that. But we need to filter those out. So we need to step up our soul winning. And those CDs, see, I was thinking pretty big. Thank God, Pastor Anderson, he gave us all those CDs for free. All those Christmas CDs. He's a real generous person. And he's got nothing in it for himself. He's just trying to spread good news and be a blessing for people. And I thank God for that. But see, he only had so many to give, and he was giving them out to different churches. And I told him, I forget the exact number, but I mean, we got like thousands of those things. And you know why? Because I know we have people here that go out and committed to doing soul winning. But you know what we need to do? We need to step it up and make sure that we get all those distributed before Christmas. You see what we have to do. They're all out there. I want every single one of those CDs gone by Christmas. That's our goal. And I don't want to fall short and have to tell Pastor Anderson, yeah, I know I ordered this many from you and asked for this many, but we didn't get it all done. No, we're going to get it all done. There's a lot out there. Take them with you, and let's get serious about not just handing out the CDs. I mean, reaching people, getting the work done. Let's use the excitement of being in a new place to propel you further into reigniting your zeal for reaching people. We need to do this multiple times a year because it's easy to fall into routines. It's easy to fall into habits. It's easy to get a little dull when it comes to, it's time to go soul winning. And, not that you don't do it. You do it. You do it regularly. You kind of do it consistently. But we need to just reignite that fire and that zeal and understand again and think about it again about the importance of it. Think about the importance of people not going to hell. Think about the importance of changed lives. Not just their eternal destination, but how about getting into church? I mean, I thank God for my salvation when I was 20 years old. I mean, of course, there's nothing more important than that, but you know what the next best thing was after that? Was finally getting plugged into a church. Unfortunately, though, it was after I had already made a bunch of mistakes that had I gotten plugged into a good church, I wouldn't have made. Because I would have had a lot more wisdom and a lot more understanding and can avoid the wrong path in many aspects of my life that you can't go back and change would have been done differently and would have been better, and there would have been a lot of sorrow and grief that I could have avoided by getting plugged in church. Don't forget that when you're going out and talking to other people. They probably don't even realize how much they need to get into a good church. I didn't realize how important it was after I got saved. I didn't know how important it really was. And hopefully you understand how important it really is. Because there is always a draw. This flesh is always going to try to get the upper hand and draw you back and bring you into the world and get you to be non-effective and lead you into the ways of destruction. Sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. And it is. And if you allow yourself to just go down that path and just get backslidden, nothing good is going to come of it. We need to make sure that we're staying in church, in a good church that's going to warn you, it's going to remind you things that you already know, but just bring it back into your remembrance. Oh yeah, this is really bad. Oh yeah, I can't allow myself to start becoming more and more tolerant, and it's not that big of a deal. Because that's what happens when it comes to sin, any sin. You don't just wake up one day and just start getting into some horrible sin that you never would have done. It's a progression. And it's a lot easier to progress down that path when you're not hearing from God's word on a regular basis. You start thinking that everybody drinks a little bit. Not that big of a deal. You start thinking, it's time for a Christmas party, right? We just had our Christmas party at work. I didn't go because of the drinking aspect. I chose not to go. Because I don't want to be around that. I don't want to start getting soft on this area. Well, but everyone's going to be drinking. Yeah, I know. I don't want to be around that. I don't want to be tempted. I want to take heed, lest I fall. I don't want that to happen to me. Let's take Stronghold Baptist Church to the next level. It's going to require a lot of dedication to God and to your church family. We saw in 1 Corinthians 12 about, you know, looking, you know, the members looking out for one another. Being there to edify and to support each other. Everybody's got different things going on in their lives. We need to remember that. And especially when people haven't been here, where you notice someone not coming to church, please help me out. And try, as if you know that person or if you have their contact information, you know, I try to keep up with everybody, but there's a lot of people. And I don't even always know everybody, and especially as we started, there's some people that unfortunately that have kind of slipped through the cracks from my radar just because I didn't get a chance to know everybody right away. And I don't want that to happen. I definitely don't want that to happen anymore. I tried yesterday just to call, you know, a bunch of people and see what's going on, but I didn't get through to any of them. But as a church family, everyone needs to be, you know, involved as much as possible. And you don't know people here, get to know everybody. We need to rely on each other. We also need to go all in. Be willing to sacrifice your time. Be willing to do whatever, you know, you prioritize for yourself. But if you think the things of God are important, you probably do, it's why you're here. Identify how important is that to you. How much time are you willing to invest? How many other things are you willing to sacrifice in your life? What, you know, nothing wrong with having fun, but just, you know, decide for yourself what is it that I want to make sure that I'm doing, and everything else takes a back seat to that. Next year is going to be awesome. I know it. God's already been at work here. And I'm looking forward to what he's going to use this church to do. Just keep in mind that he's the one that gives us the power. It's not our own might. We rest in ourselves, trust in ourselves. It's not going to get done. And God will show us real quick how weak our flesh really is. But if we go out with the right attitude, the right mindset, we're looking out for each other, we have the mind of Christ, God's given us the mind of Christ. We know what it is. We go out humbly. We preach the word of God. We love people. We love God. There's going to be a lot done here. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for allowing this group to come together. We thank you for building this church, dear God, and we ask that you'd please continue to build this church. Help us to become better servants, better workers, dear Lord. Help us to gain more wisdom and more knowledge that we can really just put into use and reach more and more people with the truth. God, help us to do that. And we ask for your power. We ask for your blessing, Lord. And I pray that you please strengthen our church. Strengthen this body. Help us all to come together under the headship of Christ, that we all have the same mind of Christ, dear Lord. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.